out of the main vent, and we'll ask Port Nienis to come and tell us about the secrets of the atmosphere of Titan. Courtney's independent research position follows postdoctoral placements at the University of Hawaii, UCL, and our own synchrotron, where he's worked in the field of astrochemistry. And across these placements, he's devised and constructed a number of laboratory setups to replicate and study the chemical reactions that we can observe in the extreme space environments. So the challenge is to reproduce those conditions in some sort of laboratory condition and see if we can get the modelling right. So complex organic molecules, the building blocks of biological material on Earth. Put in.
Hoping to stand at the front, so am I projecting okay at the back? Can you hear me okay? Alright, if I start to trail off, just give us a wave and I'll retreat behind the microphone, no offense taken. So, well, thanks for inviting me along. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's such an honour to be at the Society tonight to talk to you about a bit of my research that I've done both overseas and brought back here to Melbourne, which has been formed at the Australian Synchrotron, but also the La Trobe University, where I've pursued an ARC Decorate Fellowship at the moment. So, always like to start off with this slide, going back to what I believe is kind of the roots of laboratory astrochemistry, where we have these two famous gentlemen here, Stanley Miller and Harold Urey, who at the University of Chicago in the late 1950s. They had this rather ungodly setup just here to try and recreate the early Earth's atmosphere. So this is a reducing atmosphere with very simple molecules that we see up here, water, methane, ammonia and molecular hydrogen as well, so a reducing atmosphere for which they then place electrical discharge through it. And what did they find? They found a whole swathe of amino acids and rather building blocks of life as we know it. So this experiment here, this is our first forays into what we consider astrochemistry, where we have very simple molecules and we're trying to build up their complexity by introducing a discharge or a source of energy to break up the bonds and form more complex matter as we go forward. So over the last 60 years or so, we've been trying to refine these techniques by having different precursors, but also known quantities of energy that we're introducing to this system, and using more advanced analytical techniques to deduce the compositions of these molecules that we formed in these systems. So we refine this over time using more modern kind of ultra-high vacuum techniques and cold substrates as well, which I'll go into a bit further. Okay, so astrochemistry. What's astrochemistry? And I like to describe this as kind of a cycle between three interconnected fields. Originally, this is all embarked from observation. So the astronomers use their high-powered telescopes, but also more advanced spacecraft missions to deduce what the chemical environments are in the planetary system, the solar system, and further afield into interstellar space and other galaxies as well. So observation, where we retrieve signatures, spectra, that indicate what kind of chemicals are harbored in these environments. We then use this spectra in the laboratory to weed out these lines and get pretty good indication of what molecules we're dealing with. So in the interstellar medium, for example, we found up to 200 different molecules just by going through the spectral signatures in the microwave region and radio telescopes. And this doesn't include isotope substitute species as well. So 200 just natural abundant kind of species in the interstellar medium. So then in our experiments, we get what these signatures are. We perform reactions with these to build up the complexity. From there, we feed data to theoreticians who use very complicated computer models, networks of chemical reactions, and plug these in, let them compute, and then they indicate to us, okay, we're missing this molecule. This should be out there to complete our model. So they pass this back to the astronomers, who then go out searching for these molecules to complete what we think are the missing elements or missing molecules in our reaction mechanisms. And this is an onward cycle. So we're refining over time, finding more complex molecules in space, but also extracting data as to how these molecules form from very simple precursors. So we keep going around this cycle. Where do I fit in? So I'm a laboratory astrochemist. So I like to use machines to mimic these space environments, be it planetary surfaces or interstellar space, the ices that coat interstellar grains. And from these condensed phase reactions, we introduce energy, either by photolysis or fast particle radiation, onto this ice to induce chemical reactions, which we can then extract kinetics, reaction barriers that we can then feed to the theoreticians. So I kind of sit in here. Sometimes I do some theory in my downtime between synchrotron experiments, but mainly laboratory astrochemistry. And what we're hoping to do is locate spectroscopic signatures for key intermediates in the formation of prebiotic molecules, amino acids, nucleotides, these kind of complex organic molecules, which then I handball to the astrobiologists. I don't like to get any bigger than amino acids. Oh, that's where I step back and say, okay, I'll leave it up to you guys to come up with your RNA world hypotheses, your deep sea trenches where these guys can form into larger biological systems. So this is where I jump off. So between about 6 and 20 atoms, that's about my limit. Okay, so talking about these pathways, these are really complicated. So the theoreticians, they might have networks of hundreds and hundreds of coupled reaction chemical reactions, or with their own kinetic rates, or their own abundances, which they then compile in their computers and they just let them run. So we might start off with just introducing energy, breaking some covalent bonds to form atoms and reactive intermediates. These might be radicals, these could be ions. But then in step-by-step processes, we're building up the chemical complexity and forming, okay, from stuff that we consider to be quite dangerous here on Earth. We've got hydrogen cyanide and we've got formaldehyde. These are the essential precursors that, through these reaction pathways, stereosynthesis is just only one example, which has been known for 100 years or so. We have these precursors, and under stepwise conditions, we can build up to more complex molecules, such as these glycine molecules just here. So that's what the double arrows involve. Obviously, this is step by step, building up complexity over time by introducing energy to these rather cold environments. So yeah, we can form amino acids, we can also form sugars, and potentially nucleotides as well. If you look at these cyanide molecules, you can see that, okay, we can form nitrogen-containing heterocycles under certain conditions. If we zap the nitrile and they link up into aromatic or heterocyclic species, we'll go into those a bit later. So now there's two competing kind of environments where these reactions can occur. Ideally, we like all these to be neat in the gas phase, where we just have our molecules, and in the cold depths of space, they'll just bump into each other, zap, and form different molecules. But we know that this doesn't occur this way in interstellar regions. These are high vacuum environments. These collisions aren't very frequent. So they also need activation barriers if we have neutral molecules here. So these are pretty unlikely to occur and build up the complex molecules that we've seen in our astronomical surveys. So this is only half of the puzzle where we have these gas phase reactions, but they do not account for the observed abundances that we see. We need another environment. And this is where I come in. It's solid state. So interstellar space is not empty. We know that. It's not a complete vacuum. We actually have these large dust grains that are either carbonaceous or silicate. And in cold interstellar regions, cold planetary environments, these can form ices on the outside. Molecular ices, water predominantly, but these other species as well can condense onto the surface to form an ice coating. This ice coating is then exposed to energetic particles, where then we have these reactions forming in the condensed phase. This is a lot more favourable to form larger molecules. We have neighbouring atoms, which if they introduce the energy, we can form higher order species. Over the evolution of, say, an interstellar dust cloud or a star-forming region, these mantles can heat up, and then these complex species can evolve into the gas phase, where we then detect them by our observation, our telescopes. So we have these now two pathways to forming higher order species, the gas phase, and the solid state. So this is where I kind of focus my attention in the solid state by devising experiments to mimic these reactions that occur on the dust grain surfaces. Well, these experiments look like, so this is probably the latest project I worked in at UCL in London. So a lot of times we work with ions because they're easy to steer, they're easy to focus, and we can irradiate a surface that way. But that's not necessarily how a lot of these reactions take place. A lot of time we just want reactive neutrals, radical species, to react with the ice. But radicals not being charged, they're hard to focus, they're hard to steer around onto a surface. So we had to devise a way to go about that. So here we form a radical beam apparatus where initially we form the ion, the anion in this case, so a negatively charged species, which we can then filter and focus and then steer around the corner here, 90 degrees, where we overlap it with a laser. With that laser, we flick off that extra electron, leaving us with the neutral radical that we're after. So that neutral radical can then pass down this this length of tube and then hit our surface where we can monitor the reaction. How do we monitor these reactions? Well, those who are familiar with surface science might be familiar with these techniques that we use. We use ultra-high vacuum conditions, so large turbo pumps, large ion pumps to get down to 10 to negative 11 torr or something around those regions, where we can then analyse solid state by infrared spectroscopy and also XPS as well. If we want to look at the covalent bonds with X-rays, we can do that. We also can monitor the gas phase using mass spectrometry. So we just heat up the ice, evolve the gas, and then we count what our products are that way. So these are typical surface science techniques that we then adapt into our astrochemistry kind of experiments to determine the new products that we formed in our ice after irradiating them with radical species. So this is all up and running now, and the first kind of results are coming out soon. So we're looking at mainly molecular oxygen at this point in time and oxygen atoms. Okay, so topic of my talk is Titan. So Titan is probably within the solar system most exciting astrochemical environment for us to study, just because of the amount of molecules that we've noticed there over time. We have known about Titan, this fuzzy orange ball, for quite a while. Discovered by Christian Huygens in 1655, he just named it Saturn's moon. Up until John Herschel here, a couple of hundred years later, he focused on the Saturn system, discovered a few more moons, Mimas and Enceladus, but also gave the series of moons their names after Greek gods. So he named Titan in 1850. So over time, we've looked at this kind of orange ball and been frustrated that we can't determine more about it, we can't see its surface. It's got this hazy atmosphere, impenetrable to most wavelengths of our light. So this has been a source of frustration over time. Spectroscopy advances in that, we've determined more and more of the chemical composition of Titan until NASA Voyager 1. So this is a flyby mission, so just a fleeting kind of look that we had at Titan in the early 80s. So this got quite close to Titan's surface with the sun backlit, sun shining through the outer regions of the atmosphere just here, and we could sample the outer atmosphere and determine what the chemical composition was. So this verified to us the abundances of nitriles, of hydrocarbons, of these organic species that reside in the upper atmosphere, that even though it may only receive 5 to 10% of Earth's sunlight, of UV radiation, still a highly active chemical environment. This UV is able to initiate a lot of chemical reactions within this and form higher order molecules. So Voyager is still out there. About 20 billion kilometres from Earth right now, and still talking to us, sending out the odd signal. So it's out of reaches of the solar system, where it's pretty much done its work. So this laid the foundation for a lot of what we know about the physical conditions of Titan's moon. So we know that it's predominantly nitrogen, much like our atmosphere, which is not so small, a fair chunk of methane in there, and a little bit of hydrogen as well. So this is that reducing atmosphere that Miller and Urey studied in their early kind of astrochemical experiments. Like I said, we see a small amount of the UV from that Earth does, but it's enough to initiate ion molecule chemistry and radical-radical chemistry in the atmosphere to form these higher order species. So we've got a suite of C2 hydrocarbons, but also small nitriles, which I'm particularly interested in these species here, with a carbon-nitrogen triple bond, quite a strong bond. We've also seen seasonal variation in the detected species. So Titan orbiting Saturn, Saturn orbiting the Sun, it has seasonal variations in its UV exposure, and that dictates what we're seeing is in the atmosphere as well. So I've got another slide later for the higher to describe that. We also have the haze layers. So the complex organic molecules and the polymer tholum protoproducts. This gives Titan its orange appearance. These are pretty much impenetrable to most wavelengths of light and blocks out the surface features. So previous, well, right up to Voyager, we were really unsure what resided below that haze atmosphere. So we need a new space mission to determine what the internal terrain and surface features of Titan looked at. And this is the Cassini-Huygens mission. So this is kind of like where my story starts. So just here in January 2005, this is when I started my PhD at the University of Western Australia. So I followed on from a guy who followed the Jovian mission before that to Jupiter's moons and looked at Europa and those kind of missions. So Titan was my baby, so to speak, and I followed that through all the way through my kind of PhD and postdoctoral scholarships after that. So postdoctoral placements. And unfortunately, I followed it up through to its death just a few months ago. So September 2017, when I seen, we just plummeted the Cassini probe into Saturn itself, just wiping it out, making sure that we can't contaminate Saturn and its system. We've left it pristine in that way. That's a nice story where, okay, I followed it from the start, the descent of the Huygens probe that we see here. This is pretty much just a mass spectrometer with a few other instruments that descended down through the haze layers of Titan, sampling the atmosphere as it descended. So we got our best look at the atmospheric composition of Titan. We also had this GoPro attached to it as well, so we got really cool images as it descended and broke through that cloud layer. So this is kind of some artist's impressions of what we thought Titan's surface may look like. Got this water ice here, then rock as well. Okay, liquid hydrocarbon surface. The hydrocarbons in the atmosphere might sustain that through the equilibrium with the liquid on the surface. And like I said before, the GoPro attached to the Huygens probe, dropping down, haze layer, can't see anything, then bang, underneath that cloud deck. Look at that, just marvellous terrain. Mountains just carved out, so we can see all these kind of fluvial erosion. Evidence for liquids on the surface. And here, this to us looked like a cryovolcano. So all this bright material that's been coming out from a crater at the top, replenishing the surface with material from the interior. So we're really interested in these cryovolcanic mechanisms. What forms a liquid in the subsurface, what processes brings it out to the surface and then distributes it in this way. And this is Huygens' resting spot, where it came down on the surface, and you can see these rounded kind of pebbles as well that show okay, it's been rolling down a kind of riverbed, rounding the surfaces. So lots of evidence for liquid water, I mean liquids, hydrocarbons, even though I didn't notice it on the surface at the first time. But yeah, for my kind of PhD project, we're really excited by the cryovolcanic activity and what is the mixture that's been dispersed onto the surface. So these are kind of models that existed at the time. Okay, we've got this ammonia water kind of clathrate or below the surface. So this could be a liquid in its eutectic point. Under pressure, this could be brought up to the surface in channels and then distributed onto the surface. Water, as soon as it hits the surface, 94 Kelvin, forms rock hard ice. But to that point, prior to Cassini and in the atmosphere, we could see no ammonia, no signatures for ammonia, only the molecular nitrogen in the atmosphere. So we're wondering about this, okay? We required these clathrate materials to be liquefied and brought up to the surface. Where's this ammonia? What's its fate? So I set about performing some experiments to determine the fate of the ammonia on the surface of Titan around these cryovolcanic kind of vents. Okay, so we know that if it's distributed on the surface, are we going to be damaging the surface material through the radiation of particles as well? So you see Titan out here, it kind of orbits on the periphery of Saturn's magnetic field, where there's charged particles, there's radiation that's trapped, and they can bombard the surface. So Titan's rather dynamic in the way that it weaves in and out of the magnetosphere of Titan. So it's seasonally exposed to particles within the magnetosphere, but also seasonally exposed to particles in the solar wind from the sun as well. So it's rather dynamic, lots of different particles, lots of different processing that can penetrate the atmosphere of Titan and perhaps irradiate the surface and induce some chemistry on the surface, which we're excited about. So that's an important thing to note, that the radiation in terms of energy is enough to penetrate through this extended atmosphere and actually influence the chemistry on the surface as well, which is important for what we're looking at. Okay, so just in my PhD years, the first technique we used is matrix isolation, because we're looking at the irradiation products, which are kind of excited reactive species that you can't just keep as a normal ice because they react too quickly. So what we have to use is an inert solid, argon, so we're trapping our reactive species in an argon matrix to look at specific spectroscopic signatures of our radiated products. So the design of the experiment was, okay, we have our water and we have our ammonia, two components of this clathrate material, and we're going to irradiate it and break these kind of hydrogen bonds to see what the products are. And we're going to do this sequentially. We're going to break the bonds in water and we're going to break the bonds in ammonia just by exposing it to electrical discharge, a car ignition coil connected up to our gas deposition line. So coupled with some theoretical calculations, we see that, okay, if we form the hydroxyl radical by breaking the covalent bond of water, we actually form the immediate water complex that we have here, and we can see that through these signatures. Okay, we have the OH stretch here, but we also have this rather prominent water ammonia complex species that stands out on its own. So okay, when we break the water up, we form this complex, but we also form this by when we immediately irradiate the ammonia as well to form the complex. So we see that either way, by exposing the water to irradiation or the ammonia to irradiation, we're destroying the ammonia. The water is happy to pitch a hydrogen off the ammonia to form this complex. So the ammonia is doomed either way. The water is either irradiated or the ammonia is irradiated. So we're sequentially destroying the ammonia by capturing its hydrogens, and then you can feasibly say, okay, stepwise, this is going to form our molecular nitrogen at low temperatures while restoring the water component as well. So this is probably the mechanism for the fate of the ammonia on the surface, where, okay, we may irradiate the water, it is the bulk material on the surface, but that's going to deplete the ammonia complex on the surface. So we kind of came to the conclusion that any ammonia that's brought up to the surface from the subsurface is going to be depleted, eventually forming molecular nitrogen, which is outgassed to the atmosphere. So that was my PhD studies, where I then went overseas to University of Hawaii and performed a few more elaborate kind of experiments where, instead of looking at matrix isolation, we're just looking at the bulk ice here. So we're depositing our, say, interstellar or planetary ice surface, and then probing the chemistry that's induced in the ice with infrared radiation. So this is RAIRS experiment, so reflection, absorption, emission of infrared radiation, where we can tell online, as the chemistry is happening, what's occurring to our reactants and our products. So we see our reactants drop and our product abundances go up. So this is all online. We have our radiation source here. So we use protons or electrons for radiation. And then we can look at the gas phase as well through temperature programmed desorption. So we're looking at the gas that's evolved. So here's just a typical experiment where we turn on our ion source. We introduce energy to our bulk ice, and then we observe the reactions that unfold using the infrared radiation, the signatures of each of our chemical species. We can quantify the amount of damage that we do to the ice. We can simulate this by, okay, we shoot a proton into our ice, and here what you see emanating out from the ion trap is these secondary electrons, which are stripped off the ice component as that particle penetrates into the ice. It's these secondary electrons that do the chemistry. So they're rather low energy, so they can be captured by the ice itself and then break the covalent bonds and induce the chemistry to form our secondary products that way. So it's not essentially our initial radiation source, but the secondary electrons within the ice that induce the chemistry. So we can model this and determine exactly how much energy we've inserted into our solid to extract the reaction rates. And then finally, what we're looking at is what we call the temperature program desorption. So we heat up our substrate, ramping it from say 20 Kelvin up to room temperature, 300. And at each molecule's specific sublimation temperature, it's going to come off the surface and we can capture it with our mass spectrometer there. So, okay, we might have water and methanol. So these are both alcohol type species. They come off around 150 Kelvin. So we can determine at what temperature each of our species comes off the ice using the mass spectrometer there. And typically we're looking at bulk ices, so around 100 to 500 nanometers, so quite big depositions as well, just so we deposit a lot of the energy as that iron penetrates. So these are our typical examples. I'll start off with a really simple system here. So we're looking at molecular oxygen ice. Molecular oxygen, diatomic homonuclear kind of species, so spectroscopically rather boring, doesn't have a lot of signatures. So we have a nice clean background, pure O2 ice signatures here. So you see this ripple, that's from the internal reflections of the infrared light bouncing off the inner and outer interface of our ice. But here we can see after we irradiate it for quite a long time, 72 hours at rather high currents, 5 kilo electron volts energies, we can see that we're processing the ice and forming new products. Far and away, the biggest product that we see is ozone, just by breaking up the O2 bond there and then forming O3. But after we heat up, the different spectrum we can see, okay, look, we've actually formed new chemistry by implanting our radiation source into the ice. So we see evidence here for water and D2O2, so we're using deuterium, so we don't have the background interference from water in the chamber. And we can see that, okay, by implanting D+ into our ice, we're forming new species, much like we would do in space by the proton getting onto this ice. We're forming water from molecular oxygen ice. How do we verify this? We use our temperature program desorption, the sort of mass spectrometry that we saw before, and we follow each of our kind of mass to charge ratios, our Daltons for each of the species over time. So here you can see our temperature ramp, and that, okay, at each specific sublimation temperature, we get a readout for what's in the gas phase. So here, molecular oxygen, our original ice, that's by far and away the biggest kind of signature. But then we also see signatures for, okay, our water and our ozone buried underneath down here. So once all the molecular oxygen's gone, we can focus this around our D2O at 150. So we're looking at mass to charge 20 here for our D2O, and we see that, okay, we form some heavy water from our radiation of deuterium atoms into oxygen ice. So we've got our data, and I told you that we're collecting the signatures online, so as we irradiate, and we can see over time how each of our products increases in abundance in the ice. So this is using the integrated infrared peaks and fitting that over time. We can fit this in our models to extract the kinetics of how quickly or we're forming these species relative to each other. So here for ozone, you see, okay, we form ozone really quickly, but then it levels out, meaning we have the formation and destruction processes reaching that equilibrium where we're destroying ozone as quick as we're forming it through the D+ irradiation. However, you see that, okay, water here, that's increasing over time. So this is kind of a secondary product. We have different kinetics occurring for water than we do for the ozone. So after fitting these kind of curves, we extract our kinetics, and then we come up with these elaborate kind of reaction pathways where we have our starting material, we break up our starting material to get our end products. So lots of forward reactions, forward and reverse reactions. Like we said, we're destroying the ozone as quickly as we're forming it. And then we have all these coupled reactions to determine what's going on in the ice. And from a very simple kind of system where we just have molecular oxygen and deuterium atoms, lots of reactions, lots of rates that we have to consider for what's going on. So the most boring kind of plot, these are all our reactions that we come up with, here are all the reaction rates, but these are what theoreticians love. They just love having their kinetic rates and plugging them back into their networks and finding, okay, we've accounted for the water formation now through this pathway, how does that interact with every other pathway that we've got? Inserting these in might be a frustrate them because it throws out their other reactions, so we have to go back to the drawing board for others. But this is, yeah, this is what it all boils down to, which we then feed to the theoreticians to validate what we see through our observation space. So just looking at a few different systems. So now we're building up the complexity here by when we had oxygen ice before, we're looking at CO2 now. And instead of D+, we've got D2+, so the deuterium, molecular deuterium cation, irradiating surface, and we're just using this because we've got a lot higher flux. We've got a lot more of these species to hit at the surface, so we don't have to irradiate for 72 hours. I can just sit at the bench for 10 and do the job. So once again, CO2 ice, a bit more complexity with the infrared signatures now, but once again, after irradiation, we see that, okay, ozone, another common product, but also carbon monoxide and a few other species. So these are the most abundant products we need to essentially evaporate off our CO2 before we see these deuterated implantation products. So we have our heavy water again, some DO stretches and whatnot. So we don't have complete validation of what these molecules are, just kind of bonds, functional groups, if you will, of what's in the ice. So now we have to go back to our temperature program desorption. Okay, sorry, these are actually the kinetics again. So we're following the integrated infrared lines over time. We see our precursor CO2 drop off over time and all the products increase or flatten out. Various different kinetics. So we have this cyclic carbon trioxide species, which is a key intermediate. And we see that quickly form, then kind of exponentially decay away until we get to this kind of temperature as well where something's going on at this point. And what's that? That's the formation of, in the ice, carbonic acid. So we know this is unstable in terrestrial kind of environments. It breaks up to water and CO2, but we can actually track this and look at it in our interstellar ice. And you can see that this is probably a pretty important precursor. So the two hydroxyl bonds there, you can see how it'd be an intermediate in a lot of this prebiotic chemistry that undergoes. So we're quite excited to see this for the first time trapped in a CO2 ice. So then we devised, okay, what's our reaction mechanism? What's going on? First, we're breaking up the CO2, forming oxygen atoms, which we can then form this cyclic trioxide species. And then we're sequentially adding a deuterium atom to form the carbonic acid that way. So from CO2, the implantation of deuterium, forming more complex species, which is what we're hoping to do. Here's our network, all these forward and back reactions to get our carbonic acid, our final products. Fit these to various models to see which one gives us the lowest residual error, and then extract our pathways that way. Pass on the data to the theoreticians. And finally, just to mix things up, we don't always irradiate with protons, we can with heavier atoms as well. So this is oxygen implantation. So here we have our hydrocarbons. We want to insert oxygen into this ice and form alcohols or carboxylic acids, something along those lines. So these are quite heavy, of course, so they impart a lot of energy into the ice. And what we actually found was we actually had some residue left over on our surface after the irradiation. So we formed this orange polymer kind of coating, similar to what you see in the tholins, looking at Titan's atmosphere. So we're quite excited to see this as well. This is after high temperatures. We have refractory organic residue remaining on the surface. this polymeric hydrocarbon kind of species on the surface, which is exciting to see. TPD again, so we're just following the kind of products that we form. We see these kind of suite of molecules, and some it's a bit frustrating because we can't determine if we've got methanol or molecular oxygen from its mass to charge ratios. So we have to couple this together with the infrared spectroscopy to determine what we've got. And these are the kind of mechanisms that we see. So either starting off with our ethane, we can dehydrogenate. So we're stepping down to ethylene and acetylene. Or we can insert oxygen into the methane that we formed as well. So we couple together all these kind of hydrocarbon reaction mixtures with oxygen to extract these rates, and we see, okay, we even see reaction intermediates here as well. An intermediate which we fit to the ethylene. So ethylene is quickly transformed into acetylene through losing more hydrogen, so we can follow those kinetics as well. So this is my time in Hawaii, sitting up on the lab overlooking the campus where everyone's in their board shorts and going down the beach, and I was doing these kind of experiments for 2 years. So this is just a short selection of the experiments that we looked at, different ices, different radiation sources, and trying to step up the complexity of our ice mixtures, but also determine the rates that goes on there. Okay, so that's Titan ice, I guess, and now Titan atmosphere. So coming back from overseas and going to the position at the Australian Synchrotron, I didn't have the similar setup that I had before. I had to adapt, and what we did have there was a cold cell that simulates Earth's atmosphere using liquid nitrogen cooling. And I said, okay, how can I adapt this to my planetary chemistry that I'm looking for? So I switched directions to Titan's atmosphere, where here we have this nice little cartoon with the temperature profile. So you see that, okay, altitude of 140 kilometres, it's very extended, this atmosphere. And all this kind of dynamics that goes on, where we have condensation, we have all this UV-driven chemistry up the top, so we have this golden haze that's formed. And as it descends, as it settles towards the surface, it meets the atmospheric cold trap at the tropopause, where we have condensate and we have cloud formation for eventually precipitation of the material onto the active surface that we saw with the Huygens probe. So we have the liquids there, the cryovolcanic activity, a rather dynamic environment, anyone can say. So what's happening as we follow it down, we have our largest precursor molecules. We have molecular nitrogen and methane. Methane is broken up by UV photons, and then molecular nitrogen by, we need charged particles to do that. This triple bond, nitrogen triple bond, is very strong. So we need charged species, fast particles, to break that up, forming this suite of secondary products that we've detected with the Huygens probe through spectroscopy, including, so we have straight chain hydrocarbons, but also these nitrogen species here, these nitriles. Not much oxygen, so reducing atmosphere, all the water is locked on the surface. Any water that is introduced is coming from the external Saturn environment and stays as kind of solid form. So there's only very trace amounts of CO2 and carbon dioxide, so not much oxygen in the atmosphere, which kind of simplifies things. But in that way, it's more complex because we have these tholin polymeric species that are formed way up here by the UV exposure to form these large, high-mass species that we've detected with the Huygens probe through mass spectrometry. So polyaromatic hydrocarbons, heterocyclic nitrile species, these settle down as they grow and then act as condensation nuclei for any ices that form in the low Earth's atmosphere before they precipitate down. So we want to emulate these kind of systems in the lab. This guy here, Carl Sagan, he's a pioneer in this kind of research. So his thoughts were, okay, how are these condensates going to form? It's an onion model, where, okay, if we go back and we look at the temperature profile of all these species, these all condense at their own specific temperatures. So depending on how volatile the species are, they're going to condense at different stages as that aerosol particle descends towards the surface. So we have layers. We might have a tholin large kind of interior, where then we have nitrile species condensing as a shell. Then on top of that, we have higher hydrocarbons as the outer layer before finally methane ice can form on the outside. So what we have are these layers of different chemical compositions exposed to radiation, and we have an interface. So we know chemistry loves an interface where we have different kind of systems interacting there at that point of contact. The rings of the onion, do we form higher complex species at those interfaces? So these are kind of questions that we pose and try and find out through our synchrotron studies. And this is just a quick diagram to show that yes, we do have different radiation sources interacting with our particles at different altitudes as well. So okay, we have our abundances of our species, but also the total energy deposited. It's quite high when we get to the surface. So you think that most of the energy might be used up in the upper atmosphere? No, we're still exposed to the aerosols are still exposed to high amounts of energy to induce some chemistry as they settle down towards the surface. So Cassini itself took some spectra of Titan's atmosphere with a backlit sun, and its onboard spectrometer, luckily for us, overlapped mainly the far infrared region, which the synchrotron's particularly good at or adept at using to determine chemical information. So these are low frequency kind of modes, mostly associated with large amplitude, kind of floppy motion of the molecules, but also condensates. So these are the lattice modes of a crystalline substance, the molecules in their specific positions. They vibrate in their condensed phase, and we see these broad features that indicate condensed phase ices. So we've seen these ices. Some of these peaks we can assign to certain carriers, such as this one down here. We have cyanoacetylene just here. But here at 220, this is a big unknown species that we haven't been able to assign. So I particularly want to use this synchrotron to try and deduce what the carrier for this 220 absorption species is in the atmosphere. So this is kind of the cartoon that I came up with. Okay, Saturn's orbit is around 30 years. So we sampled, you know, a transition in seasons for Titan as it orbits around the sun. So in its orbit, we've seen the summer moving into winter, and then we see the increase and decrease of this feature indicating seasonal variations of our chemical species in the atmosphere. So this is exciting to us. We know that okay, it's UV kind of processed, that abundance is due to the amount of UV exposure that Titan gets as it orbits Saturn. So it's quite interesting. Kind of limits the amount of species that we can look at as well, which takes us to the synchrotron and the cold cell that I was talking about. So this is just essentially a gas cell which we can cool down to liquid nitrogen temperatures, and then we can inject our molecular species that we're interested in to form aerosols. And then we use the synchrotron light source to interrogate those aerosols as they're formed. So we can get the particle dynamics, their growth over time, but also their chemical composition. So these are the physical parameters that we're working with. Liquid nitrogen, we use heaters to bump that up a little bit, and then nitrogen pressures as well. So we use nitrogen to emulate the Titan atmosphere. So we're essentially mimicking certain regions of Titan's atmosphere where these aerosols are hoped to form. So hydrogen cyanide would have been the ideal species, being the most abundant in the atmosphere. Unfortunately, the safety people at the synchrotron weren't too keen on the shared facility and all that, bringing in the hydrogen cyanide, but said, oh, why not look at some solvents we got sitting on the shelf. So acetyl nitrile and ethyl cyanide had to do in this work. So these are both identified in Titan, but around 10 to negative 8, 10 to negative 9 number density, so a few orders of magnitude less than the hydrogen cyanide that would be ideal to work at. We have multi-pass optics as well, so we can get long path lengths to interrogate the aerosols once they're formed, and then we can sample them over across the whole infrared region, from the far infrared right up to the near infrared as well. So what we want to look at is the morphology, so using the far infrared to look at the crystalline kind of microstructure of the aerosols that we're forming, extract microphysics, such as the nucleation rate and particle size distribution, and then just the chemical composition as well, informing these ices. If we have a binary phase ice, are they interacting, are they mainly segregated into certain grains, or do we have a mixed particle species? So we can, should be able to tell that in the far and wide bands as well. So relating it back to Titan, these are the altitudes that we have the nitrile cloud deck, so these condense at a bit higher altitude, a bit colder, a bit warmer, before we descend down to the colder cold traps where the hydrocarbons can then form. So we have these, what we figure are these two distinct layers, where if we have a condensation nuclei settling down, it's going to form its nitrile shell first and then its hydrocarbon shell after that, so as we descend down to the surface. And these are some of the densities that we're talking about before. So, yeah, a few orders of magnitude less for these species that we can look at, but they do condense at around the same altitudes and around the same temperature. So the best model as we can hope for. Here is what we can actually sample at the synchrotron. So we are overlapping, you know, the temperature and the pressure profiles of Titan's atmosphere. It's a rather good simulation of Titan's conditions to form its aerosols. So what do we get at the end of it? Okay, we look at different nitrogen pressures and we inject in this case, acid nitrile. So we see that, okay, using the medium infrared, this is the extinction spectrum. So we have both the absorption of the acid nitrile, but also the scattering of these particles, which is size dependent. So we have the infrared light coming in and then scattered off the aerosol depending how big it is. So we extract the particle size distribution by fitting this kind of incline of the baseline, and then these are our kind of sizes of particles we're looking at, you know, of the order of 50 to 100 nanometers. And we can do this for different pressures to see how they're kind of grown. We can also get the crystal phase of the acid nitrile. So acid nitrile at low temperature can exist in different orientations in its unit cells, so we can pinpoint exactly what that crystalline picture is. And then, as we said, the scattering and fit that to different kinds of systems as well. So there's some chemical information and some microphysics information as well. And we also see that, okay, these lattice bands, which are at the lowest frequency due to the vibrations of the acid nitrile in the unit cell, these are temperature dependent as well. So if we can use Cassini data to locate some of these bands and see their actual positions, we can actually use this as a temperature probe of Titan as well at certain altitudes. So we can use chemical information to extract the physical conditions of Titan by using the far infrared in this kind of manner. Then moving on to ethyl cyanide, much the same, where we fit this to our particle size distributions and we see that we have slightly larger particle sizes for our propionic nitrile aerosols, and then looking at the spectra as well, just determining what the phases are in the medium infrared. Okay, remember how I talked about, okay, we have this 220 haze feature, which we weren't sure what the carrier was? 220, large band associated with propionic nitrile. This isn't the lattice band, this is actually the lowest frequency fundamental band, so the movement of the propionic nitrile bending around the CCN stretch. The CCN structure. And we see this aligns quite nicely with the 220, so it could be a candidate, although here we don't see the crystalline lattice features so much as well. So if it was in its crystal phase, we'd expect both of these to be present. If it was in amorphous, it could resemble this, but we need some more work to pinpoint if propionic nitrile ethyl cyanide is the carrier for 220. People at the moment are probably erring on the side this could be a mixed phase ice, so ethyl cyanide mixed with other nitrile species condensed at the same temperature to depress this kind of absorption peak, but leave the 220 intact, the fundamental feature. Okay, so that's Titan, but as I said, the scene has now come to an end, so I'm looking for another object of affection. And so what is happening at the moment is the New Horizons mission, which has just gone past Pluto, and it's on its way out to the very far reaches of the solar system to look at trans-Neptunian objects and the ices there. So what we know so far, particularly from Pluto and the data that's just come out recently about its surface composition, that's remarkably similar to Titan in the way that it's dominated by nitrogen but also methane ice. Now from these reactions, so like I said before, Titan's only got a small percentage of the sunlight we have. Out here, very few UV photons to play with to induce much chemistry. However, we have seen a similar suite of the products that we've seen in Titan's atmosphere residing on the surface and in the tenuous atmospheres of Pluto and some of these far-reacher ice bodies in the solar system. So we're trying to draw parallels between Titan and what we can predict to happen on these trans-Neptunian objects as we get a better glimpse using the New Horizons spacecraft that's on its way out there at the moment. Would we have complex organic molecules residing on these surfaces? And this is particularly exciting if you follow the kind of hypothesis that a lot of these prebiotic species were transported to an early Earth from a comet or likewise. So all these icy bodies that have similar compositions to those of comets, and this should be able to verify to what limit complex organic molecules can be formed in these surfaces but then transported to an early Earth, potentially kickstarting life. So 2021, I think it's reaching a few trans-Neptunian objects, so we should have a better glimpse of what's going on there. And then also the Kuiper Belt, so this is a bit more relevant to the comets as well, where we have these essentially ice blocks way out in the tenuously tethered to the solar system, which are the source of a lot of these long period comets that then occasionally drift into the inner solar system and depositing their icy bodies, icy content, I should say. So what's particularly fascinating to me, looking at crystal kind of species, crystalline ices, is that, okay, these objects are way out in the distant solar system. They have surface temperatures around 30 Kelvin, really cold. We expect any ice to be formed on these surfaces as amorphous, as kind of fluffy ices. But through our detection, we've seen that water ice is actually crystalline material. Water ice, if you have amorphous water ice, you need to anneal it to 150 Kelvin to induce the phase transition to make crystalline water ice. So what's going on? How come there's crystalline water ice in these really distant bodies? So, you know, is it internal heating source from radiogenic decay of nucleotides, or is it cryovolcanism that we saw before that's replenishing energy to the surface? Is it micrometeorites hitting the surface and depositing energy that way to anneal the ice into these crystalline species? So that's kind of where I'm going to tie in my future work in crystalline ices to these KBO objects and trans-Neptunian objects. We're doing that at the moment at the synchrotron. We've come up with this surface science system that mimics crystalline ice, and then we can use the far infrared radiation of the synchrotron to probe the molecular content there. So this is similar to the University of Hawaii system, where we form thin films of the ice through chemical vapor deposition, and then we can exert, hopefully in the future, we're going to actually use UV source to induce some chemistry in this ice as well, and use the far infrared to interrogate what's going on. But similar techniques, TPD, RES, to what we use at Hawaii to look at these ices, the crystalline phases. Since I'm at the synchrotron, I only get to do experiments, you know, 6-8 weeks a year, so I've got a lot of time to sit at my computer and play around forming crystals. So I'm now kind of a theoretician, modelling these crystalline species and trying to predict what the infrared bands will be from the lattice modes. So here we need to use kind of diffraction data, X-ray structures, crystal structures, as our starting points. And then we use kind of quantum calculations to optimize the crystal structure and then extract out the infrared frequencies that we can then look for in experiments. So it's just a way of coupling together experiment and theory, and being able to assign what these lattice bands are. A lot of the literature, we know what all the internal fundamental modes are, but a lot of the lattice modes are not assigned, they're just known as lattice modes. But I want to know specifically what motions in the ice induce these bands, and also the different phases, the phase transitions as well. So we've started off with just some organic ices, so typical products that we may identify out on these trans-Neptunian objects, as far as, okay, we have our original methane and our water ice, and okay, if we irradiate that, what are they going to be the most common targets that we're going to see? So we see methanol, acetaldehyde, and acetic acid building up complexity. where from the crystal structures we can derive these in the using theory. Here you see the unit cell mapped out. And then we can predict what the far infrared spectra are. So they're those black traces. These are our theoretical predictions of its far infrared ladder spans. When we deposit at low temperature, we always form the amorphous ice, big, broad, ugly kind of bands, until we anneal it up to its phase transition temperature, and we see that, okay, now we're starting to get some substructure here. This is where we start to see the crystalline kind of modes come out, and we compare that to our theory. So, some success more than others. Methanol, that gave us a few headaches to try and get. We haven't really got great synchrotron data there. But as we move to acetic acid, which we have these rather strong hydrogen bonding networks going on, we get rather nice prediction of the fundamental modes, but also these lattice translational modes down here. So pretty close to what we see. And we're pretty excited to move on with this and build up the complexity of these molecules, particularly nitriles. Here, so acetic nitriles, it's got its two phases, so we can actually determine which phase we formed in our ice through prediction of the alpha and the beta phase, and we see that, okay, we have a much better simulation of the beta phase, so we can pinpoint exactly what phase our methanol ice is under our conditions, extrapolating that back to what phase we expect to see in these transneptunian objects. So, for our grants and when we come to justify why we're doing these experiments, remember that the onboard spectrometer that we had a lot of success with on Titan, that used the far infrared. And if we can use this data to pre-program to predict what bands we want to look for to pinpoint these molecules, we can use theory to say, okay, look, we need to focus around this region to identify this ice and look for tracer species, tracer signatures to determine what these are. And for pure nitrile, so we're going back to our nitrile systems. This is the first time we couldn't find any data on the crystal structure for ethyl cyanide, so we had to do that ourselves at the power diffraction beam line. So this is quite nice work that's about to come out, where we've done the crystallography ourselves, we've done the theory ourselves, and then we're comparing it to our experiments. Except our experiments aren't that great to compare it to, so that's where it kind of fell short. But yeah, we'll push forward with these kind of systems and move towards more mixed phase ices as well. It's unlikely that we're just going to have pure propylene nitrile sitting there. It's going to be mixed in with water ice, so we're going to see how these molecules interact with each other. So finally, one molecule that's excited the kind of community at the moment is vinyl cyanide, which has just been detected in the atmosphere of Titan. And people are proposing that this is big news for astrobiology, because we can polymerize vinyl cyanide, much like we do in industry here, to form surfaces, to form vesicles, to form interfaces. So with vinyl cyanide, if this is transported to the liquid ethane ocean, will we form membranes? Will we form surfaces which we can then have separation of pH, separation of electric potentials, potentially to drive higher organic chemistry going on? So having detected vinyl cyanide, that's a big move. So we quickly went to our computer, crunched the numbers, and you can see that, okay, for our thin film of vinyl cyanide, acrylonitrile, our predictions are excellent there. So we're really excited to come up with some signatures, particularly around 250 wave numbers, which is removed from the water ice, but we should be able to detect vinyl cyanide in the solid state. So this is work that's about to come out there. Okay, if we use the far infrared, we should be able to identify exactly where vinyl cyanide resides in these ices. And kind of future work is, okay, we're going to attach our UV source and induce some chemistry. So, okay, we have our nitriles. If we put in an inert matrix, can we form these higher order nucleotide kind of species through the CN bond, coupling around into cyclic species? So we're excited to play around with these a bit more, using UV source, seep these into our ice, and see if we can get these prebiotic kind of species. I'd just like to wrap up there. Thank you for your attention. I'd just like to thank my students who worked so diligently in the lab accumulating this data. Evan and Don, my kind of mentors in local astrochemistry. Evan with the aerosols, and Don, just general astrochemistry, just knows it all. Synchrotron crew, they've been great help accumulating my data, and also the AIC funding there. And thank you for your attention. It's been great being here. Cheers.
There's obviously enough chemistry out there to spend many lifetimes of research and many students. And Courtney is happy to take some questions. I'd like to start with one.
Sure.
If you make an amino acid that has a chiral centre, does it come out with the right configuration for biological reaction?
No, we're strictly received in the way that we make our kind of chiral centre. So that goes back to even the Miller-Urey experiments where, you know, the formation of just dumping energy into the precursors, we have no kind of selectivity in the chiral.
So you just get the racemic.
Yeah, we just get the racemic. I think if we can get the racemic centers, you need that kind of interface. So I think in the far infrared, that might be a future work where we have kind of layers of our species there orientated in very specific ways. Can we get some selectivity there in the chiral centers? So that'll be further down the track once we get a better handle on layering these species and the interfaces.
Any questions?
A slide probably about maybe two-thirds of the way through. Taking a look at the upper atmosphere of Titan, and there were a few influences there that looked rather interesting, but you didn't mention very much about them. And that was charged particles and cosmic rays.
Yes.
So I'm just wondering whether they're not just a source of energy, but actually, you know, kicking off some sorts of reactions that are taking place in the upper atmosphere. And could you comment on that?
So the cosmic rays, they're highly energetic. We're talking, you know, mega to giga electron volts. So they can penetrate a long way.
Yeah.
But just like a bullet moving through matter, they do a lot of damage, and all those secondary electrons that they scrape off along the way, that induces a lot of chemistry as well. So it's mainly the molecular nitrogen where we're looking to break that triple bond there, that we need the cosmic rays and we need the heavier iron species to break up that triple bond and then form the nitriles that way. But as far as the cosmic rays themselves interacting and, say, analogous to those implantation reactions that we saw before, don't see that occurring.
Yeah, I was thinking more about like the electrosatinate magnetospheric electrons and stuff like that.
Okay, so the magnetospheric particles. So you might have oxygen cations and nitrogen cations as well. They're a bit low energy, so I do think depending where they fall, they are funneled towards the polar regions as well, much like the aurora borealis like we have here. So the I think they would have more to play with the actual kind of latitudes of the chemistry as well, where if there's more high concentration of those species up towards the poles, we may say different chemistry, and that may manifest in the seasonal variations that we see as well. So that's an interesting point as well.
Some of the earlier experiments passed sparks through gas mixtures and generated compounds by the electrical energy.
Yep.
Is there any evidence of lightning on any of these
Yeah, so I'm not sure the other instruments that they've got on board for how they infer lightning, if they're looking for kind of iron species or even a magnetometer or something like that. I'm not aware if we've seen explicit evidence for lightning. I imagine with the amount of cloud cover and the amount of material in there that, feasible that you're building up that separation required, but I can comment on any specific observations that verifies that.
Any more questions? Yeah.
What was your favourite Cassini moment?
Favourite Cassini moment? So I actually, it's like a lot of people, but when we saw, this isn't Titan, but Enceladus, where we saw Enceladus, this is one of the smaller bodies orbiting Saturn. And it's in this gravitational tug of war with Saturn itself and Titan and the larger moons that we've seen there, essentially being torn apart, and all this water ice plumes going off into the actual orbit of Titan itself. So before we thought, okay, water's not going to play a large part in the atmospheric chemistry because it's all locked to the surface, but we've since discovered that there's actually a large influx of water ice into the Titan atmosphere through Enceladus, releasing it, bursting at the seams basically, and ejecting it into Titan's path. So yeah, those first images of Enceladus crack geysers going out hundreds of kilometres into
there were photos in the media.
Fascinating, yeah. So, and just think of, okay, planetary light timescales, and they were all there just for that moment, just to witness Enceladus, yeah, its demise. It's, yeah, that was a pretty exciting moment. Yeah, the death of those.
Any more? Yeah, up there.
So, next mission to Titan. What instrumentation would you like to see on it to solve your questions?
So, I think we've got a lot of mileage out of the far infrared spectrometer. I'm a bit biased there, that a lot of my data is in the far infrared. But I think, you know, this, I'm fascinated by this proposed Titan boat landing into the ocean and, you know, just floating around. If it can sample the liquids.
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, that's something we've seen ice, we've seen atmospheres, but the liquid phase, we know the liquid drives a lot of the chemistry here on Earth. It's essential for biology and chemistry in essence. And what goes on within that hydrocarbon mixtures that are there, what various chemistry, what higher order species. So something that samples that liquid, so mass spectrometer, just sucking it up and seeing what's in the liquid would be really exciting.
One more off the bat, I think.
It's heartbreaking. You saw this kind of pulse on the screen of just this kind of signal relay back to Earth and then flatline. And then everyone watching silence.
Which is what I wanted to ask you, because obviously you've been spending such a sustained period of time on this project. And now, obviously, it's you're having to move on to something else, which is obviously the crystals
processed is probably enough for, you know, generations of scientists. Just yeah, so there's so much more we have to tease through. The fact that, you know, we've just seen that vinyl cyanide, the acrylic nitrile now, through, I think that was the ALMA telescope actually, but then tying back, okay, we've got those signatures from a different source, can we use the Cassini data to see locations, latitudes, different clouds where that might exist? We'll be going back and revisiting this data for So, yeah, even though SAT's gone, you know, in a way it's a bit of relief because that's the cap on the data now. there's not going to be more coming through, no more surprises. But massively successful mission, just to think that it's been orbiting there for as long as it had, 12, 13 years or so. Didn't really skip a beat, you know, just a marvel engineering kind of feat that, you know, we've learned so much from it. And then these follow-up missions, just exciting about what's going to be posed next or kind of what we'll see out there. So yeah, it doesn't stop. On to the next thing, New Horizons.
So I think we'll ask him if he will go to thank.
Courtney, that was fantastic. I actually liked the interplay of what I took as two stories. One was his own mission, which was PhD, UCL, Hawaii, Australian synchrotron, and following the missions. I think that's very exciting. I think it's a great little interplay of what do I do with my time in science. I interweave it around those very nice experiments that NASA's doing. And the second one was actually, how do we actually make sense of all that? You've got data coming from probes that are millions and millions of miles away, and you're sitting in your lab going, okay, I'm going to try and work out what the heck the chemistry is going on, and then match that up. And I think that's actually a nice example of how science answers what's seemingly a simple question of, you know, how could life probably evolve something, or what's actually up on a moon that's orbiting Saturn. So I think thank you for sharing those two. I think those two stories, your science story and your personal story. And I'll